The Toys for the Community Care Toy Shop will be picked up tomorrow on December the 4th by 9:30, so please be sure to drop off your donations before then. Now let us turn our minds and hearts to the worship of God. During Advent, those who are able are invited. Oh, is it the prelude now? I haven't done this before. During Advent, those who are able to stand are invited to stand for our call to worship. Please stand. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. Let us walk in the light of the world. Let's sing hymn number 9, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel.
Please be seated.
Good morning.
Is it working?
Yes.
Today we light the first candle of Advent. In this season, when days grow shorter, when there is more darkness than light, we may feel that hope is equally fleeting. Yet God's word assures us that light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not, cannot, and will never overcome it. We light the first candle to remind us that in Jesus Christ, light has come into the world. Not a fleeting or temporary light, but a living, breathing light. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world."
Please join us in the responsive reading of prayer in your bulletin. In this season of waiting for you, Lord,
we trust and give good night. We rely on your mercy. We find shelter in your steadfast love.
In this season of waiting for you, Lord,
we walk in your way. We follow your example of love. We keep our covenant promise.
In this season of waiting for you, Lord, in this season of waiting for you, Lord,
we wait for your salvation. We wait for your leading. We wait for your coming.
Come, Lord Jesus, come.
Amen.
Please stand as we sing and rejoice. Emmanuel's coming.
Please be seated. Today we are entering into the season of Advent and preparing for Christmas. And I see a lot of red in the congregation in celebration of the season and perhaps for another reason as well. It strikes me that the liturgical color for Advent is the same as the liturgical color for Lent, that is purple. Advent is a season of waiting and preparation. Lent is a season of penitence. And the two often go hand in hand. And so as we wait for the Lord's coming, let us silently confess our sins before God and then join together in our unison prayer of confession. Together, God of the future, you are coming in power to bring all nations under your rule. We confess that we have not expected your kingdom, for we live casual lives, ignoring your promised judgment. We accept lies as truth, exploit neighbors, abuse the earth, and refuse your justice and peace. In your mercy, forgive us. Grant us wisdom to welcome your way and to seek things that will endure when Christ comes to judge the world. We offer our prayers in his name. Amen. Here's the good news from the Gospel of Matthew. Mary will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Sisters and brothers, in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please stand. Amen. Please be seated.
The anthem this morning, Arms Around the World, is a great one to start the new year with. And it reminds us in its words that you might be the only face of Christ that anyone sees.
Broken hearts, crying eyes, wait alone in the dark of the night. It's time we went beyond the walls of our own lives. It's time we bridged the distance. It's time we heard the cry.
One by one, hand in hand, heart to heart,
oh, we've got to understand.
There's so much more to life than living yesterday.
We've got to make a difference. We've got to make a way.
Let's be the hands
that comfort every cold and lonely man.
Let's be the feet
for those who do not have the strength to stand.
Let's be the love
that reaches out to every boy and girl.
Let's be the arms.
Amen. We have been concluding our stewardship season over the past few weeks for that very reason, that we can be the arms that reach around the world. And Christ calls us to commit our lives to Him and to His church through stewardship.
Oh, there it goes again. I'm sorry for the interruption. No, in honesty, I set this alarm after I saw our financial and attendance numbers for November. You see, we averaged 75 people less on a Sunday in November than we did Sunday in November of last year. Our November contributions totaled $26,000 less than November last year, resulting in us being $62,000 behind in giving year to date compared to this point in time last year. And it puts us $83,000 behind budget. I know all churches have a summer slump. However, we've continued to trend downward into the fall. When our attendance and offerings are less in November than in July, that's concerning. So it just seemed to me like I needed to set an alarm, that maybe we needed a wake-up call. Just felt like we may be kind of asleep. Friends, we're in the process of working on a budget for next year. Our best indicator for preparing a budget is our most recent history. Based on our current collections and 2018 pledges, we may have some tough choices as we prepare the budget for this coming year. Now, I realize that I'm preaching to the choir. As many of you are both faithful in your attendance and in your giving, I do ask, however, that all of us look around on Sundays. If you notice someone is missing, don't wait on someone else to reach out and check on them. Please reach out. Check on them. Invite them back to church. Let them know they're missed. You should receive your statement of giving in the mail in the next couple of days. Please review the status of giving to our church. I pray that December finds us faithful in our attendance and generous in our giving. Thank you.
Thank you, Wayne. God does call us to be a people of generosity, not for ourselves, but for the next generation. And so we invite our youngest members to come down front at this time to join Miss Sophie. Good morning. How is everyone?
Good.
I'm just really confused right now because today is a super special day. I have my birthday crown on and I figured you all would like bring a cake or something. Did you? You didn't bring anything?
No.
Not a present?
We bring presents. I bought a dinosaur.
Did you bring it for me? For my birthday? Because today marks
exactly 8 months and 9 days since my birthday, and that is a reason for celebration. And I figured for sure you would bring a cake or something. I really like cookie cake for future reference, okay? But it's okay, I'm gonna forgive you, because it's a lot to remember to celebrate this with me this morning. But in 2 weeks, on December 17th, please do not forget your birthday spirit, because we are coming right here, and we're gonna stay all day long, and we're gonna celebrate Jesus's birthday, and you won't forget that one, right? You promise you won't forget? You don't even, pinky promise, that's the real promise. You don't even have to bring the cake, because I will bring the cake for us. And we're going to celebrate Jesus' birthday at Bethlehem Birthday Bash. And then all of you are invited to come join us at 4 o'clock to celebrate Jesus' birthday and walk through Bethlehem and visit all of our shops that our young people will have set up to sell you some of their crafts that will be sure to adorn your trees and your mantles this Christmas. And then that will be followed by our stable service. So it'll be a really special day. We hope everyone will join us back at 4 o'clock. And you all, plus a whole lot more of your friends, like the balcony is empty, all of your friends need to join us that day as well. Can you do that? Oh, good. I hope two of your friends. You can bring four, okay? All right, let's close in prayer. God, we thank you so much that we have the freedom and the joy to celebrate your birthday this Christmas season. We pray that you will continue to prepare our hearts as we wait for your coming. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's return to our seats.
In response to Jesus' love for us, let us give generously of our tithes and additional offerings. For the gift of this day, Lord, we give you thanks. For the many gifts you have given us even already this day, we give you thanks. As we return a portion of those gifts to you, we pray that you would use them to share the good news of your coming throughout the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. As we turn to God's word, let us turn again to God in prayer. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. We've already said today is the first Sunday of Advent. Today is also New Year's Day for us. We've been anticipating this day the past few weeks, saying that while the rest of the world begins the new year on January 1st, we, the church, begin the new year today. For those for whom 2017 has been more challenging than usual, that may come as good news. Today is a fresh start. As Scripture tells us, the old is gone, the new has come. Happy New Year. The difference in our New Year's Day isn't just the timing, though. It's also in the way we celebrate. We don't begin the new year with fireworks and party hats and champagne toasts. We begin the new year with quiet anticipation and waiting. Driving here this morning, it struck me as timely that we woke up to a morning of heavy fog, as if once again we are waiting for the light to break through the darkness. The word Advent is derived from the French word meaning to come. So we call the season of Advent, Advent, because during these 4 weeks, we are waiting on Christ's coming. Next week, we'll look at two different biblical characters and their response to Christ's coming. Today, we look at two texts that consider how we wait for Christ's coming. We begin with the prophet Isaiah. Our passage takes us near the end of Isaiah's prophecy when Isaiah and the people are anticipating God's restoration of their homeland in Jerusalem and throughout Judah. That anticipation didn't come without its share of challenges, of course. There were plenty of naysayers among them, and resources were wearing thin. In Isaiah chapter 63, the prophet pleaded for God to look down from heaven and see their situation. But the situation must have been pretty dire. Looking at all the chaos around him, Isaiah goes quickly from asking God just to look down to begging God to tear open the heavens and come down. Listen for God's word from Isaiah 64. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when the fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil. To make your name known to your adversary, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in their ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We've all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you. For you have hidden your face from us, and had delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. In the New Testament, we turn to the Gospel of Matthew, where we find the disciples asking Jesus about the end times. We often hear talk of the end times whenever there is war or rumors of war or natural phenomena, such as this year's total eclipse of the sun, or when certain calendars tell us it's the end. The most recent occurred in September, when it was believed that another planet was going to come crashing into ours on Saturday, September 23rd. Leading up to that day, that fateful day, or as it turned out, not so fateful, morning radio shows had fun playing a certain R.E.M. song and talking about the end of the world as we know it. One asked if life on Earth were to end on Saturday, and the only thing left to tell the next generation about planet Earth was our cell phones, what would the next generation learn about life on Earth based on what they saw on your phone? One of the DJs said they would learn that humans need reminders for everything. Truth. I used to have a fairly decent memory, and then Siri came along, and all I have to do is say, Siri, remind me to, and Siri has now become my brain. Or my favorite was the last DJ who said, based on our phones, the next generation would conclude that we haven't progressed much from the days of ancient Egypt. We still talk to each other in pictures, and we still worship cats. Jesus told the disciples what they could really expect would happen in the end times. And if you like suspense thrillers like I do, the ones that leave you hanging on the edge of your seat, this is as good as it gets. Nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There'll be earthquakes and famines. And that's only the beginning, Jesus said. Well, when will this happen, they asked. No one knows, not even the Father, Jesus said. So how can we prepare for it? Jesus gave them one two-word instruction. Listen for God's word from Mark chapter 13, beginning at verse 24. Jesus said, but in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when that master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all. Keep awake. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. 'Twas the night before Christmas, and I was 15 years old. My parents had finalized their divorce just a few months earlier, so it was a rather different Christmas for my family. My mom's parents, my grandparents, drove down from Augusta to spend the holiday week with us in Atlanta. On Christmas Eve, the four of us had a quiet dinner. We went to worship, and then we all went to sleep. About 5 o'clock in the morning, I felt someone nudging my shoulder. It was my grandfather. I've never met anyone who anticipated Christmas more than my grandfather. My guess is he had been lying in bed awake all night, waiting for Christmas morning to get here so he could wake us up. And I was the lucky first victim. Time to get up, he said. It's Christmas morning. Hurry, you don't want to miss it. I mentioned I was 15, right? If you are a teenager or you ever had a teenager in your home, you know that given a chance to sleep in, a teenager won't see morning. And so I pulled my blanket over my head and mumbled, "Okay, Papa, I'll be right there. Just give me about 6 more hours." Not only is my grandfather enthusiastic, he is also persistent. "Go wake your mother," he said. I dragged myself out of bed, trudged down the hall, and called into my mother's room, "Mom, Papa says it's time to get up." "Go back to bed," she said. "It is 5 a.m. As a teenager, I don't think I've ever been so eager to obey my mother. I walked back down the hall, passed my grandfather on the way, and said, "Mom said go back to bed." And you know I always do what I'm told to do. Not to be defeated, my grandfather said, "Fine, I'll go make breakfast." Now, I'm not much of a cook. I don't know nearly as much about cooking as my chef of a husband does, but I'm pretty sure I know this. I don't think making breakfast requires pulling out every pot and pan from the cupboard and dropping it on the floor. After about 10 minutes of listening to metal clanging, my grandmother, my mom, and I gave in and reluctantly came downstairs, where we found my grandfather sitting at the dining room table with a pot of hot coffee and some biscuits he had made, and with this poem that he had written. "'Twas Christmas morning, and in the town of Atlanta, nothing was moving, not even Santa. So I got the paper and made me a cup and sat at the table waiting for all to get up. Not a sound could be heard, not even a peep. All were upstairs, trying to sleep. I thought to myself, why sleep? For you know, if you close your eyes, there are not too many Christmases to go. Why sleep?" When I read this poem, I think about how often I am asleep, how often I am not alert to what it means to prepare for Christ's coming. There could be a number of reasons for that. On the one hand, we have all the hustle and bustle of the season, the decorating, the baking, the gift buying, the shopping, the cooking, the year-end deadlines, parties, drop-ins, even church events. All this whirlwind of activity could lull us into a kind of sleepwalking as we just go through the motions. On the other hand, while our calendars tell us to hurry up to the next event, Advent tells us to hurry up and wait. That can be equally challenging, if not more so, because how many of us are good at or enjoy waiting? We sometimes prefer to be in that flurry of activity rather than just sitting around and doing nothing. But the waiting of Advent is not about doing nothing. It's about the most important work of all, waiting on the Lord and being awake to when he shows up. Yet some of us love our sleep too much. As we kick off another Advent season, let's start with the most basic of questions. Do we believe that Jesus is really coming back? That question was posed by the Presbyterian Outlook magazine last month, and I've been thinking and chewing on that question all week as I got ready for Advent. Do we really believe that Jesus is really coming back? More often than not, when we think of Advent, we think of Christ's first coming as a baby in a manger. But Advent is also the time when we focus on the promise that Christ will come again. When Jesus walked the earth and promised he'd be back, the first disciples in the early church thought he would return in their lifetime. But then time marched on as they lived day after day after day with still no sign of the Savior. What had once been this eager anticipation that got them out of bed every morning suddenly became a faint dream whose details they no longer remembered. I can relate to that. Do I honestly wake up every morning or most mornings or even some mornings thinking, maybe this is the year or even this is the day that Christ will come back victorious and make everything right again? 2,000 years is a long time to wait. On top of that, Jesus gave us a rather mixed message. He said, the signs of my return are visible if you're looking for them, but not even I know when the Son of Man will return. The snarky side of me always chuckles a bit when we put a date on Christ's return, like September 23rd, and I think, well, we can check that date off the calendar because no one knows the date. Still others defend their predictions, saying, yeah, but we have seen the signs. So which is it? We will be able to know, or we can't possibly know? Or even more to the point, so what? When I was serving on staff at the parachurch ministry called Young Life, we were told that the most important question to consider when preparing a message for our weekly large group gathering was that question, so what? So what difference does this good news of the gospel make today? If we take Jesus at his word that he will return, what difference does that make for our current living? That's kind of the rub of Advent. We sing our Advent hymns dutifully, maybe sometimes impatiently, longing to get Jesus in that manger so we can sing our favorite Christmas carols, the ones we already hear everywhere else we go. Mighty gates lift up their heads, and watchmen tell us of the night, but everyone else shouts of sales, holiday decorations, and gift giving. So why are we looking not just for the birth of Jesus, but also the return of Jesus? Why can't we simply enjoy the Christmas parties and Christmas carols and Christmas lights? In short, because we desperately need not just Emmanuel, God with us, but we also desperately need the Son of Man, God for the world. We need to be both claimed by God and transformed by God. Without this proclamation, strange and mysterious as it is, of Christ's coming, Advent slips easily into sentimentality and cheap grace. On the other hand, an emphasis only on Christ's return leaves us sitting alone on the judgment seat. We need both God with us and God who is assuredly on the side of the oppressed, the vulnerable, the weak, the helpless, anyone who is in need of mercy and grace. And for the record, that should cover all of us. We need the one who came as a weak little infant in a manger to identify with us. We need the one who took our place on the cross and declared victory over anything that would rob us of life on both sides of the grave. And we need the one who promises he will come back to seal the deal. Recognizing the tension between trusting that the Lord is on his way but not knowing when he will make his appearance makes for lives of daily faithfulness. Lives marked not by fear and anxiety but by hope and expectation that the Lord is near. That's the so what of all these clouds and trumpets and falling stars and fig trees. We know whose we are. We know whose future is sure. We know who is the potter and who is the clay. And if we know who we are and whose we are, we also know that the waiting of Advent means there is work to be done. One of the other passages we often read in Advent is when John the Baptist comes on the scene and declares another prophecy of Isaiah, prepare the way of the Lord. And we hear that prophecy echo throughout the season because we know that is our mission as well. As people of the way, we are to prepare the way. Let me offer an illustration to explain what that means. Ever been anticipating a trip to another country? Usually you anticipate that when you arrive in that country, you'll experience some degree of culture shock. Some people try to alleviate some of that culture shock by trying to live as if they are already in that foreign country long before they step foot in it. I have a friend, Kate, who regularly goes on extended mission trips to Kenya. In the week or two before she left, she began eating some of the same food she would eat. She tried walking more than she drove as much as possible, and most importantly, she tried living on Kenyan time here. One time when I was getting ready to go to Kenya, I tried that experiment. I don't think I even lasted 2 days before I decided jet lag sounded easier than getting up at 1 a.m. and going to bed at 5 p.m., all while trying to maintain my normal life in Atlanta. Friends, Scripture tells us we are ambassadors of a foreign country. Our citizenship is in heaven. As we make our home away from home here, we are to help people prepare for that glorious culture we will experience when Christ comes again. So here's the question. If Christ were to return today, how much culture shock would we and our neighbors experience? If Christ were to come today, would people around us say, huh? What kind of life is this? I've never seen this kind of joy and peace and forgiveness and restoration. Or if Christ were to return today, would people say, oh, I recognize this. That's how Jesus' followers have been trying to live the whole time. Advent means coming. The root of the word advenir also means to cause to come, to usher in or bring about. We don't get to know the day or time of Christ's coming, but we can help usher it in by preparing the way and living the way. Each season of Advent urges us to consider, not just as a thought experiment, but as a real life exercise. If today is the day the Son of Man returns, what will he find me doing? It reminds me of those billboards and bumper stickers we see that say, Jesus is coming, look busy. Some of us have that look busy thing down pat, maybe too well. Preparing for Jesus' return is not about idle busyness. It's about active waiting. If Jesus were to return today, would he find that my thoughts and words and actions were aligned with his character and instructions and mission? If not, and let's be honest, we all fall short. We need both the grace of the manger and the grace of the cross. If I'm falling short, what do I need to do differently? And am I willing at least to attempt to do it? Not out of fear or complacency, but out of a desire to worship, follow, and honor the one who says he is my Savior and the Savior of the world. How do we prepare the way? Two words. Keep alert, says Jesus. Stay awake. Don't be complacent or cynical. Don't walk through life drowsy or numb to the present or the coming kingdom. For the world is about to turn, and we need to be prepared to turn with it. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our hymn of preparation is Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. We will be singing the version found in hymn number 2.